Praise be to God. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Don Jason, and it's a pleasure for me to welcome each and every one of you to Clifton Seventh-day Adventist Church. Under the leadership of Pastor Jebba Moses, we are honored to host this ordination service. All of you who have come from far, we thank you. All of you who have come to acknowledge what God has done in the life of Pastor Kojo Tomasi. We are so grateful for all of you here. Special thanks to Pastor Samson Tomasi and the family. Special thanks to union conference officials, friends, family, extended family, professors, everyone that has been, has committed or have given some contribution to pastor's life and have brought them to this far. We thank you. May the Lord continue to richly bless each and every one of you. We are thankful that you came here, and at this time, we are going to continue with this program. After we get to this point, though, before we get to this point, I'd like to personally thank Pastor Kojo for all he has meant to the Clifton family for the last 4 years. May God continue to bless you and your ministries. To God be the glory. The next voices you hear will be those of Forever Praise.
Please stand for our opening hymn.
Plane that I have found, Lord, plant my feet.
Let us remain standing as we receive the opening prayer. Precious Lord, that fine hour has now emerged. With a spirit of koinonia and solidarity, a sea of family, friends, loved ones, online streamers have convened on this celebratory, auspicious occasion to bear witness for a glorious moment that will live for infinity, the ordination and the setting apart of our brother, friend, son, Pastor Kojo Chumasi in the pantheon of the ministerial vocation. Father, one's calling is consequential because though the world is not our home, it's our calling. Today, our brother is on the precipice of being publicly affirmed, not just of a career, but of his calling. Lord, may our brother be reminded that as he pursues and engages on this spiritual odyssey, may he have the spiritual discernment to understand and recognize that he has a fiduciary duty to be a trendsetter, vanguard, and trailblazer for your kingdom. Because, Lord, kingdom building is not about personal service. Kingdom building is about public service. But above all, Lord, though this service is going to have a central fixation on our brother, this service is a testament to your thanksgiving, to your goodwill, and to your magnanimity. Lord, we are inviting your divine hand to permeate throughout this service, from start to finish, from the first participant to the last participant, from this prayer to the final prayer. Precious Lord, in this final hour, this is our prayer, this is our praise, and this is our proclamation. May all of God's people say, amen.
Kojo will do it, someone said at a missionary conference in Kenya. A group of children's ministry leaders were looking for a child to preach for their program, and they volunteered Kojo. 6 years old at the time, Kojo ran to his mom, not to his dad, a preacher, and asked for help. That moment when Kojo preached his first sermon, titled Let the Children Come, was the first time his parents realized that Jesus had put a special calling on Kojo's life. His mother, Felicia Tumasi, is here. Sister Felicia, would you please take under 2 minutes to tell us how you nurtured this gift of preaching and pastoring that God had put into Kojo? There will be a number of speakers who will be coming up, and just to help them and to help me, I have a timer here, so they will all speak 2 minutes and under. Go, Sister Felicia.
Thank you, Pastor Jeva. All glory to the Lord. Amen. Amen. Before the discovery in Nairobi, I have always believed in the Bible admonition to train up a child when he is young. We made time for Kojo and his siblings when they were young. He was encouraged to make God and the Bible the first, last, and best in his life. Even at high school, we sent him to Africa with his brother to instill in him the love for mission service. And today, we are glad that the Lord is calling him for higher pastoral services. As I call him Brother Kojo, may our good Lord bless you and guide you throughout your ministry. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Felicia. Now, I love that a mother could have said a lot about her son, but she kept her comments to a minute and 8 seconds. So for the rest of you, don't bore us. Now, thanks to the work of the Holy Spirit and the positive encouragement of peers and adults in his life, Kojo accepted the call to ministry when he was just 17. From there, he enrolled in Oakwood University to begin his ministerial preparation. During this time, Kojo spent a lot of time serving in ministry. He preached at several youth camps, retreats, conferences, revivals, and evangelistic meetings. He traveled to Kenya, Uganda, Ghana, and later to Australia to do mission work. During that time, one person who witnessed the impact of Kojo's ministry is his very dear friend, Mills. Mills, where are you? Would you share with us, in again under 2 minutes, how you saw the Lord impact Kojo in ministry?
Growing up in the North American Ghanaian Seventh-day Adventist Church, we were blessed to be able to experience youth camp. Now, youth camp was a place where it was filled with vigor in the beginning. But it was exciting. But over time, it started to wane. And as it started to wane, we got bored. And over the time, it changed because Kojo was able to bring some vigor, which was a gift from the Holy Spirit in accepting the call to ministry. And as a result, when we came to youth camp, we were excited to go to morning devotion. And so that's one way in which Kojo has been able to impact. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Mills. Mills did better. 49 seconds. The pressure is on for those who are following. Amen to that. Now, after Kojo graduated from Oakwood University, he received the call to serve as youth pastor of the church called First Ghana SDA Church in New York City. During that time, he was responsible for taking care of about 150 young people. He did it through weekly vespers, Sunday Bible classes, Sabbath sermons, leadership workshops, socials, and community service programs. Though his time there was short-lived, just a year, the spiritual impact has been felt for several years since. Fiona Minka, where are you, Fiona? If you would please join me here. She was a part of the church in New York City. And Fiona, would you please share with us how the life and influence of Kojo in New York, First SDA Ghana was?
I hope I can meet the 2 minutes. But I've known Kojo for a very long time. He was very effective in his ministry in First Ghana, especially within the youth. He was able to help us connect with God in a meaningful way by using our talents, our strengths, and our weaknesses. He provided guidance and support during challenging times. God knows how many times I've called him during an inconvenience in my spiritual walk with God. So I just want to say he was also very instrumental in creating a sense of community and encouraging us to serve one another and those in need. He demonstrated humility, compassion, and integrity in his own life, which in return, his impact gave us a sense to willingly apply the teachings and principles he shared. Thank you for all that you do with your communities and your churches. I pray that God will continue to use you to touch the hearts of his children. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Fiona. That was 59 seconds. Well, Kojo finished his first year at First Ghana SDA and then went on to Andrews University to complete his Master of Divinity degree at the Theological Seminary. Afterwards, he came home. He came to the Clifton SDA Church here in Cincinnati. Well, it'll take a long time for us to tell you Kojo's impact at Clifton. Just one incredible journey. because I might say a lot of things. We are inviting Nitza Foster, one of our members who was very positively impacted by Kojo's life and ministry. And Nitza is here to share some things with us.
2 hours, I heard.
We'll come back during dinner time.
Okay. 2 minutes. I would need 2 hours and still would be short of the time to do justice to how Kojo has impacted the lives of our youth and our church members and those of us who have had the honor to work alongside of Kojo. I'll speak mainly of his impact to our youth and to the impact as a visionary in our church. Kojo was God sent to us parents who had young kids going into preteen and teen years. Amen? You hear that? I was praying that our church could have more activities for our youth, and then God sent Kojo to our church. Thank you, Jesus. At Shandon, my youngest puts it, he said, Kojo revived our youth program when we needed it the most. Both my boys, nephew, and other young men at Clifton were able to be baptized during his time here. And I can say his teachings in the Friday night CTC were a major role for their decision to accept Jesus. Amen. Shavi appreciates how Pastor Kojo is able to break down complicated topics and ideas into simple points that anyone can understand. And that's what makes him a great pastor and a teacher. Kojo brought groups of all ages in our church together. And as a result, it has brought our church closer and feels more as a family than ever. And so in working with him, I can say everything Kojo called, okay, I'm almost done. I knew that I couldn't say no to him. I would say, yes, Kojo, what do you need for me now? So he knows how to encourage others to use their gifts for God's glory. He took our vision of renovating our downstairs here at Clifton Church, which has been a dream for many of us, and he ran with it. And during our time here, he just encouraged us, his team, and honestly, we were ready to give up many times, but he kept encouraging us and listening and believing in us. And guess what? By God's grace, it's almost done. Thank you, God. One of our parents said, he has encouraged me and my family and always believed in me and my role in my family and what he does at church, no matter the challenge. He always believes it's possible with God's direction. And two of the most important things I have to share with you as I close. As Kojo said in his goodbye to our youth, he said, if you're searching for a purpose, which I have been searching my whole life, it is to live for God and use your God-given gifts, whether it's teaching, drawing, cooking, and use it to tell others about Jesus. Amen. Lastly, I can never repay you, Kojo, how you have impacted and helped shape the mind of my young boys, or my young men now. You have my son ask questions about different beliefs and God-related topics. And when I asked him, why are you asking all these questions? You know what he said? Mm-hmm. He said something that I've heard you say in the Friday nights. He said, Mom, I'm just trying to figure out my faith so I can go from borrowed faith to personal faith. That's what you taught my young men. And so I want to thank your parents personally. Thank you from our church. I'm sure everybody will be joining me in that. And Kojo, may the Holy Spirit continue to bless you.
Amen. Well, that was only 4 minutes and 28 seconds. But she's a homegirl. All right. Yeah, yeah. Well, so finally, after 4 years, against all our wishes, you know, certain things had to be done. And so our president and our secretary, they pulled me aside and said, the time has come for Kojo to graduate and take on his own role. And so our church was very reluctant, but we said, if this is God's calling, we don't stand in the way. And our loss became the gain of our dear sister churches, Toledo First and Northwood, up in northwestern Ohio. So Kojo has been there for a little over 3 months. And I would like to say, who are our friends from Toledo and Northwood? Can we see a wave of your hands? Welcome. Good to have you all join us today. Welcome, welcome. Yeah. If Kojo does anything horrible in Toledo, blame it on us. It's our fault. But someone who has been helping in the process, who's been working closely with him, is Pastor Steve Cousins. Pastor, may I invite you to come? And if you can share a little bit about Kojo's ministry in your church district. Thank you.
Last August, Pastor Mike Fortune announced to us that he was going to transfer to a church in Central Texas. Killeen is the name. He left in October, and we were so saddened by it because he had been there for almost 16 years. That's right, folks, 16 years. The concept of our church members, how can we get along in here without Mike Fortune? It was just inconceivable. And yet Elder Condiff came to our church and visited, spoke with us as elders soon after Mike left. And we told him the kind of pastor that we need here. And of course, all these qualifications were written out on the writing board. And of course, if he got all the qualification, he would somehow be second cousin to Jesus Christ. But he said he had somebody in mind for us that would work well here. And he was right. I held the fort there for 3 months. And when he came, it wasn't long and we could see this young pastor was someone that had tremendous enthusiasm, tremendous gifts, abilities, and vision to do a great work for God. And we are so grateful to have him there. Thank you all so much.
Thank you, Pastor Steve. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, now we are going to see a video from our former conference president, Elder Ron Halverson, and one of Kojo's mentors, Tom Evans, sharing a message of encouragement.
Hello there, Pastor Kojo. Your ordination day, an exciting day. Wish I could be with you. I'm actually recording this on my phone. I'm on the road, and I've stepped outside where it's rather cold here in northwestern Washington. Wind is blowing right now. But I just wanted to say I'm so proud of you. I know your family is. I've watched God work in your life. I was privileged to see you come to the Ohio Conference when I was president there. I've watched since I've left, seeing you going literally around the world in mission service for the Lord. I know you're a blessing to the church. I know you're a blessing to God's cause. And I just want to say that Jesus looks good on you. The Bible verses in my mind are from Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will direct your paths. He's done that so far, and you just leave your life in his hands. He'll continue to do that. I'm excited about what God has already done through your life and in your life, and I look forward to seeing more of what he's going to do. God bless you. I couldn't be prouder. I'm so proud of your entire family, a family that serves Jesus with all their hearts. And you, my friend, are doing that. May his power be in you, an added power of the Holy Spirit's blessing be on you. for what is ahead, may it be even greater than what has already happened. Love you. Bye.
Older Kojo, Mara and I, along with our boys, send our enthusiastic greetings to this celebration. One of the greatest joys in my life has been to journey with you as a mentor and a friend. I remember the first time that we met in my home and you asked if I would be your mentor. That carried us all the way to Australia. We spent some great time there together in ministry. There's a saying that says, laughter is good like a medicine, and you've given our family so many doses of joy in our lives. I want to charge you with one of my favorite passages found in 2 Timothy 2, verse 2. It says this, "The things which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." I know that's your passion in ministry, to equip others to save souls for Jesus. Congratulations on this celebration. May God bless you.
So family, today I present to you God's servant, God's son, a brother, a friend, a fellow worker for the cause of Jesus. Not to glorify him, but to honor the God who takes broken vessels for his great honor and glory. My friend and my son in the faith, Kojo Tumisi.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
Our speaker today is Dr. Gregory Allen. He currently serves as a professor in the School of Theology at Oakwood University. Kojo and Dr. Allen first met in 2011 when Kojo was a freshman at Oakwood University. In Kojo's words, and I quote, "Dr. Allen was a tough, and when I say tough, I mean tough and no-nonsense professor. But even though Doc was a little hard to deal with initially, I pushed through because I enjoyed learning under him." Eventually, Kojo took every class he could from Dr. Allen and later became his Greek lab assistant. During this time, the two of them developed a close bond with each other, where Kojo considers Dr. Allen as his spiritual father, and Dr. Allen considers Kojo as his son in ministry. In Kojo's words, he says, "One of the main reasons God sent me to Oakwood was to meet Dr. Allen. God used Doc to teach me how to handle the Bible properly, but more than that, God used him to stress to me the importance of keeping Jesus at the center of my life and ministry. For that, I'm forever grateful." Accompanying him today is his incredible wife, Dr. Carol Allen, and after the music ends, the next voice we will hear is Dr. Greg Allen. Thank you.
Hello. To show them your love and your perfect plan. You gave me my ears. I can hear your voice so clear. I can hear the cries of sinners, but can I wipe away their tears? You gave me my voice to sing your word, to sing all your praises to those who never heard. But with my eyes I see your need for more availability. See hearts that have been broken, so many people to be free. Lord, I'm available to you. My will I'll give to you. I'll do what you say do. Use me, Lord, to show someone the way and enable me to say, my storage is empty and I am available. My storage is empty, and I am available to you.
Beloved, grace to you and peace from the Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I must say, Pastor Moses, that I have been taken today by the love in this church. I praise God for the Tomasi family and for Kojo. And we're going to spend a few minutes before he is oiled. Okay, brethren, oh, that's it. Now we're getting it. We have come this afternoon to witness the ordination of Pastor Kojo Tomasi to the gospel ministry. And yet, rightly understood, we gather to affirm what the Lord has already done. For it was Jesus who said, "You did not choose me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bear fruit." Therefore, Kojo has been set apart by God. Technology. On a personal note, I have known Pastor Tomasi for 12 years. We have had many important conversations, biblical, theological, cultural, and yes, even marital. I consider him a spiritual son. And so, to celebrate what God has done, the Spirit has given me a brief message entitled, Preach the Word, Timothy. Let us pray. Eternal Father, made visible in Jesus Christ, at this moment in time, as salvation history comes to its conclusion, please remove the veil of tradition from our hearts and our minds. We would see Jesus. It is in his matchless name that we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson this afternoon is taken from 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 4. 2 Timothy 4, 1 through 4. And if you have your Bible or your devices, I would like for you to turn to that passage at this time. I want you to focus on the passage as I read in your hearing. Paul writes, I charge you in the presence of God and Jesus Christ, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching. But having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. The occasion. In other words, why Paul writes this epistle. 2 Timothy is an urgent letter written by Paul to his spiritual son. Reliable tradition has it that the apostle is about to die at the hands of Nero, the pathological emperor of Rome. Paul, an apostle, is about to experience martyrdom for his faithfulness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. In other words, Paul is facing imminent death.
I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing.
Now, I realize at this moment, and Kojo would tell me this, that I am about to break their sermonic flow. But as a teacher, I must always make clear where the presentation is headed. And so, the homiletic outline. First, we will address the Pauline command. Next, we will deal with its necessity. And then finally, we will deal with the Christological implication, and then we'll lay hands on Kojo. First, as a prelude to the command, Paul issues a solemn charge to Timothy. In it, he invokes the presence of God, Father, and Son. Moreover, notice that the charge foreshadows the final judgment, second coming, and eternal reign of Christ. Therefore, this prelude of warning is eschatological in nature. In other words, it has end time significance. Yet Paul's charge serves to introduce something very important that we will talk about this afternoon. It introduces his formative apostolic command: preach the word, Timothy. Now, Pastor Kojo, please listen carefully. According to Paul, this word is to be preached whether it is culturally acceptable or unacceptable. In other words, you must preach it in season and out of season. Moreover, Timothy is to explain the word to believers. Teach, not just proclaim. He is to share the gospel with spirit-mediated patience. Timothy is to utilize the full range of pastoral tools. Tools designed to assist the spirit in producing Christ-likeness in the believers. Paul commands this young pastor to convict. The word means to expose error, to rebuke, to warn when something is about to happen, and to encourage by doing all of these things with a spirit of love. In other words, Timothy must be willing to have difficult conversations with the saints for their good. That is not popular today. And yet, Paul's exhortation, preach the word, raises an implied question. How are we to understand this command? As you will see shortly, Paul's commands suggest Christological specificity. Stay with me. Now, before we can unpack this idea of preach the word, we must identify the Pauline necessity. With the words, "A time is coming," Paul uses prophetic language to signal end time apostasy. End time moving away from God among professed followers of Christ. In context, these believers will have a form of godliness, but will deny the Spirit's transformative power. In other words, in the last days, many believers will only play church. According to the word now. Saints, please listen. According to Paul, in the last days, professed Christians, and I keep on looking back, I'm sorry, will not tolerate healthy teaching. In other words, they will demand an existential or me-first gospel. They will require syncretistic teaching, the blending of truth and error. These professed believers will look for teachers who will promote their selfish desires. Paul says that they will turn away. They will turn their back from truth to myths. Here Paul uses a literary device to emphasize his assertion. And now I want to show this device to you, and it's very important to understand what Paul is doing with it. We've got the enemy working, right? Oh, Lord. Can we take it? Oh. Can we take it back? And just move to rhetorical contrast, please. Okay. Now, Pastor, you have to give me a little bit more time. You see what happened, right? Okay, so for rhetorical emphasis, Paul contrasts from truth to what? Does everybody see it? From truth to myths. Now, it is important for us to observe that ultimately, when we talk about truth, the truth is first and foremost a person. Jesus says, "I am what? The way, the life." So Jesus is the truth. But many saints in the last days will move from truth to ultimately myths that are satanic lies, satanic, deceptive lies. allow me just two brief examples. One postmodern, the other one Seventh-day Adventist. Do you know this person? Joel Osteen, do you know this person? T.D. Jakes. If you look at the cover of the CD, Osteen says, good, better, blessed. Huh? And if you look at this book by T.D. Jakes, he says, reposition yourself, living your life without limits. In other words, beloved, both of these preachers preach prosperity theology. Prosperity theology is the fastest growing movement in Christianity in all of the world. And by the way, they only have one text. You see that text right there? I would that you prosper and be in health even as your soul prospers. They have one text in all the scripture. But what I want you to see is that prosperity theology is a conflating of capitalism in Christ. In other words, it is from what? From truth to error. And now, my second example, and I want you to put on your seatbelt. I want to take you back a bit in Adventist history, and we want to look at early Adventist tradition. There was this idea of the way of life, and it was equivalent to the way of salvation. Now, look at this picture. What do you see? Yeah, you see the whole thing, salvation history. But what do you make of this eye of God? And what is the eye teaching about God? It describes a legal, judgmental, performance-oriented God. This is a non-relational God. And let me say something personally at this point. As a Seventh-day Adventist born and raised, this is the God that I was introduced to as a child. Notice the relationship between the tree of law and the cross. Which is dominant? The tree of the law. Let me give you some background history. M.G. Kellogg introduced James White to this picture in 1873. Stay with me. This is the half-brother of John Harvey and William Kellogg. James White took this picture and put it in the Review and Herald, wrote a pamphlet, and endorsed it for the entire Seventh-day Adventist Church. Next. By the 1870s, works righteousness permeated Adventism. Did you all know that? Then, as president, James White had the drawing modified, and what do you see missing now? The eye. And so he tried to update it a little bit, and now he's General Conference President. And what I want you to see, beloved, and this is the key point, this understanding of God and the dominance of the law moves the Seventh-day Adventist Church from truth to what? From truth to myth. And you may be asking yourself at this point, why is this important? Let me illustrate. How many of you know Pastor Dan Matthews? Huh? The former speaker director of Faith for Today. After he finished that ministry, he became the associate pastor at Loma Linda Seventh-day Adventist Church for seniors. For seniors. About 2 years ago, he preached a sermon in Arizona, and he shared this reality. He said to the congregation that you have many seniors in that church, missionaries, former administrators, doctors, and they have this question that they come to him with all the time. Listen now, saints. These Seventh-day Adventists who have been in the work for 40, sometimes 50 years, they're asking their pastor, have we done enough to be saved? And now, I want you to look at this picture. What do you see? But beloved, what's missing? Now, before you think that I produced that, let me show you something. Elder White had Thomas Moran produce this new rendition January 1881. This occurs just 6 months before he died. And look at what it was supposed to be named. Christ, the Way of Life, from Paradise Lost to Paradise Restored. On his deathbed, James White told his wife, Ellen White, to promote this understanding of salvation on his deathbed. Now, I want you to get it. Ellen White and her sons published this rendition in 1883. If you know our history, this is significant. This picture became a harbinger for Ellen White's 1888 message. In other words, it became a forerunner of righteousness by faith through Jesus Christ alone. Amen, saints. And now we come to the last part. The Christological implication and the critical question. When Paul commands Timothy to preach the word, what specifically does he mean? Now, in a moment, I'm going to take you, don't go there, don't preempt, I'm going to take you to 1 Corinthians 2, 1 and 2. But before we go there, I have to first give you a bit of a backstory. Stay with me now. We're almost to the end. Paul travels on his second missionary journey to Europe. Huh? He goes into Athens and he sees idols everywhere. Huh? He sees Zeus, he sees Artemis, and he is absolutely appalled. He is horrified and taken to Mars Hill by the intellectuals, the Stoics and the Epicureans. I want you to get it now. Using this notion of the unknown God, this idol entitled the unknown God, Paul preaches a resurrection gospel. Does that sound good? However, he does not mention the cross of Christ. Now, beloved, the question is why? Why doesn't Paul bring up the cross of Jesus Christ? The simple answer is that crucifixion was out of season for Jews and Gentiles. In other words, it was unpopular in Greco-Roman culture. And so Paul did not bring it up. Now, this brings us to Paul's definitive reminder. Almost finished now. Look at this. He says, "When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except what? Jesus Christ and him crucified." Important clarification. When Paul commands Timothy, preach the word, he means preach Jesus Christ and him crucified. I want to do something at this point. I want to share with you quotes from Ellen White in support of this understanding of preaching the word.
The sacrifice of Christ. The sacrifice of Christ as an atonement for sin is the great truth around which all other truths cluster.
Stop. The sacrifice of Christ is the what?
The great truth around which all other truths cluster.
Look at this rubric. In order to understand doctrines, in order to understand prophecy, in order to understand the third angel's message or the sanctuary, saints, what must be in the center?
Christ.
Christ and him
crucified.
Okay, continue.
In order to be rightly understood and appreciated, every truth in the Word of God, from Genesis to Revelation, must be studied in the light that streams from the cross of Calvary.
Next.
Hanging upon the cross, Christ was the gospel. Now we have a message, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world, the sins of the world. Will not our church members keep their eyes fixed on a crucified and risen Savior in whom their hopes of eternal life are centered? This is our message, our argument, our doctrine, our warning to the impenitent, our encouragement for the sorrowing, the hope for every believer.
Last one.
No discourse should ever be delivered without presenting Christ and Him crucified as the foundation of the gospel. The cross of Christ, how many believe it to be what it is? How many bring it into their studies and know its true significance? There could not be a Christian in our world without the cross of Christ. Then keep it before the schools as the foundation of all true education.
Before Pastor Tomasi introduces the final question, notice what Ellen White is saying here. She's saying that the cross of Christ must be fundamental to what? Christian education. Beloved, are we doing that? Question.
Is Ellen White's focus supported by Paul's inspiration?
Stay here for one moment. We want to show you something, and I'm going to have to take this mic. Come on. Because we want to show you this idea now of holistic salvation. And we're going to do it quickly and then we'll be finished. In the center, we have the cross of Christ. Do you all see it? What we want you to understand is that the cross of Jesus Christ reveals the nature of God. In other words, the cross of Christ reveals what is called innate agape. In other words, God so loved the world that he did what?
He gave his only begotten son.
He gave his son. And think about this for a moment, saints. God knew, he knew that Lucifer would rebel. He knew that Adam and Eve would fall. Before the foundation of the world, God had a strategy. In other words, Jesus Christ was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Mm. And so through him, we have holistic salvation. And so first we have justification by faith. This is a forensic or legal term, and it's very important because it means that we have been acquitted by God in a courtroom. Now, how is this achieved? I want you to see it now, and I'm trying to see.
Sinners covered by Christ's righteousness.
Okay, that's what I wanted to illustrate. I don't have time to do it. Do I? Yeah.
I do.
Beloved, understand this, that we do not have any righteousness. Now look at that. Isaiah says that all of our righteousness is what?
Filthy rags.
It is filthy rags. So when you talk about holistic salvation, you must start with the righteousness of Christ.
Amen.
This is what is technically called imputed righteousness. When God looks at me, he does not see Kojo or Gregory. He sees Amen. The righteousness Amen. Of Jesus.
Amen.
In other words, because of the cross of Jesus Christ, read it, Kojo, I can't see it.
Me neither. Christ crucified rescues, rescues us from the penalty of sin. Put a round of applause for my eyes, everybody.
Remember that this occurs, and I can get this one.
All right.
This is done by a what? A loving Savior. Next, we move to, and we've been doing this for a long time, we move to what? We move to sanctification. I want you to get it now.
Death and life.
In other words, Paul says, I have been crucified with who?
Christ.
It is no longer
I,
but Christ who lives in me. In other words, we must participate in his death, and then we participate in his
life.
In his life. Read it, Kojo.
Transformed by Christ's Spirit.
I got to put this down for a moment. Because while this covering remains on you, the Holy Spirit has to take the righteousness of Jesus Christ and put it where? You didn't get that.
They didn't get it.
No, they didn't get it.
Yeah, do it again.
Okay. Yeah. The righteousness imputed that is on you must now become imparted.
Right there. There you go. Come on. Amen.
He must put it in you.
Amen.
It is his joy and his peace and his patience. Saints, are we getting this?
Yes.
It's going to be hard this next one to see. Okay, so you got it, son.
Woo! Christ crucified rescues us from the power of sin.
Not just the penalty, but what?
The power.
And we're talking about the everyday power of sin. Who has to do it?
Christ.
Jesus Christ. But how does he do it? Look at this.
Intimacy with a loving Lord.
Mm-mm, saints. We don't like the word kurios, Lord. But remember, intimacy with a what? A loving Lord. Huh? Jesus says, listen to this, saints. In John 15:4, he says, it must be abide in me and what?
I in you.
That's intimacy. And it must be daily in order to grow in Christ. We're finishing up right now. Justification, sanctification, and now what?
Glorification.
Glorification.
Conquerors, share in Christ's victory.
Huh? When you share in his cross, you will also share in his crown.
Amen.
Oh, Lord have mercy. In other words,
Christ crucified rescues us from the presence of sin.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
In other words,
vindicated by a loving judge.
Suppose you have a relationship with the judge.
Amen.
Then the Bible says there is no condemnation.
Hallelujah.
For the person who is in Christ. Jesus Christ. Amen, saints.
Amen.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now, saints, let me end up right here. Because remember now, we are not just Christian ministers. And I'm talking about clergy and lay. We are not just Christian ministers. We are called as Seventh-day Adventists. Are you with me? So the cross reveals a radical choice in the great controversy. And I want you to see it, and we're finished. Cain and Abel are only proxies in the controversy. Cain represents Satan, and Abel represents who?
Christ.
represents Christ. Look at the heart's desire of Satan. First of all, he wanted independence from God. A life characterized by, get this now, pride, power seeking, and self-glorification. Saints, please get this. Lucifer was motivated by this idea of what? Ascension. I will make myself like God. I want to ask you a question before we close down. Are we teaching in our homes and in our churches and in our schools success that is not motivated by God? Ascension at all costs. Let's contrast this with Jesus Christ and his heart's desire. Jesus, who was God, was totally dependent on God. Did you all get that? A life characterized by what? Humility, power relinquishing, and self-abdication. Look at Jesus. Not ascension, but what? No, you all don't like this? Jesus came what? Look at it, beloved. Jesus Christ was verily God, but he stepped down in order to become the Son of God. He stepped down to become Michael. He stepped down to become the Son of Man. He stepped down to become sin. He stepped down to become death. He stepped down to experience the second death. Jesus Christ descended into greatness. And because of this, the Bible says that God gave him a name that is above every name. The cross and then the crown. And so, Pastor Tomasi, preach the word. Do not preach self. Huh? Because it's being preached everywhere right now. And preaching self is idolatry. I'm getting ready to get in trouble now before I sit down. Pastor Tomasi, do not preach culture. Uh-oh. I have been all over the Adventist world. And even in places like India, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we are preaching caste. As I travel through Africa, we are preaching tribe. I told you I was getting in trouble. In the United States of America, even in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we are preaching race. We are as divided as Republicans and Democrats.
My Lord.
And when you preach culture, it's what?
Idolatry.
It's idolatry. Come on, saints. I'm sitting down.
Preach.
And then, Pastor Tomasi, do not preach Adventist tradition. Do you realize that this is what Judaism taught? Their traditions, and they ended up killing their Messiah.
Wow.
This too is idolatry. And so I end on the positive note. Huh? Pastor Tomasi, my beloved son, preach Jesus Christ. Preach his beautiful person, but also preach his saving work. Beloved, I want to end with the whole church together repeating Paul's seminal assertion. Let's read it together. Can you see it on the screen? Yes, yes. Let's read it together.
We preach Christ crucified,
a stumbling block to Jews and
foolishness
to the Gentile. Get it now. But for those who are called, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And the church said,
at this time, I would like to invite the candidate, Pastor Kojo, to come up here so that in the presence of all the witnesses here, we're going to lay our hands and anoint you and call you into the ministry. But Kojo, before I invite the other pastors to come, you know very well that from the day you were born, you, your brother, and your sister, every year, at the beginning of the year, January, as a pastor of the home, I will anoint you. Anoint your brother and anoint your sister. Today, allow me to anoint you one more time. Not because I'm going to die tomorrow, but because I want to hand it over to you so that this oil, you'll be using it in your ministry. James says, if there is anyone sick, anyone suffering, anoint the person. This oil, which I'm handing it over to you, will only become effective if you sanctify yourself, if you dedicate yourself, and if you do ministry the way you are being called today. So today, I hand over the oil to you when I anoint you and we lay our hands on you. Second, you remember the day we took you to Oakwood University to begin your theological training. That day in Huntsville, Alabama, if you remember, your mom and I, we gave you a Bible. In that Bible, you remember what I wrote in the Bible?
This book can keep you from sin, or sin can keep you from
sin. This book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from this book. Today, in the presence of these witnesses, as we're going to lay our hands on you, once again, I want to give you, your mom, your brother, your sister, we want to give you another Bible with the same message. Preach from this book as Dr. Allen has taught you. And never deviate from it. Humanistic preaching, Greek philosophies, they do not amount to anything. Therefore, stay close to this. And above all, read this one and find a wife. Who will be a companion in ministry? At this time, I would like to invite all the ordained ministers to come up here. All the ordained ministers who are here, we want you to come so that we're going to lay our hands on him. All ordained ministers, please up here. All ordained ministers, I also like to invite all ordained retired ministers, if there is any among us, please come up here. Then I also like to invite ministers who are not yet ordained to also come and offer their support to him. If there is any pastor here who is not yet ordained, please come and stand here and offer your support. At this time, we will ask Pastor Kojo to kneel. As all the ordained ministers, we come and kneel and lay our hands on him. And because we